Ordinances are going to be for first reading only, so the title just needs to be read. As far as the resolution relative to the implementing the traffic calming program, if you would like, you can do a quick presentation on how it got to this point and discuss the options of the public comment, just so people are aware of what's been proposed and how it got this far. Would you like to read the title and then the resolution, the description real quick?
Resolution number 2022-05, implementing traffic calming program.
A resolution of the Town Council of the Town of Windermere, Florida, implementing a temporary traffic calming program for Oakdale Street, providing flexibility to the town manager to implement the program, providing for reevaluation period after three and 6 months required in ordinance for pertinent traffic calming measures, providing for conflict and effective dates.
Robert, if you could give us a presentation on where we're at.
This was again a resident-initiated issue as far as the cut through traffic, the perception of speeding along the Oakdale Street, extending all the way from 12 to 6. We held two public information workshops. The first public information workshop, we notified those that live along Oakdale Street, and then we held an additional public information workshop on April 26th. Then we notified everyone within 500 feet of that of Oakdale Street. We did not, however, notify everybody in the Southeast Quadrant. Then we reached this LRP, had discussions during LRP, and that's where it came up with the closures of everything south of 6th. Workshop, and then we had a council meeting, last council meeting, the Town Council, and sent it to implementing a temporary measure to see if we can start curtailing some of the traffic issues in that quadrant. And we have listed in the resolution those four areas, those four items, to hopefully take care of the issue. So what this resolution does, it gives me the authority to implement one
specific to impacts of that diversion plan, it will be selected, will be selected. But it's something that an engineer would recommend that be implemented. It's not the most decorative vitals, but it's also temporary in nature, because again, after 3 months, as the president provides, after 3 months, we'll hold public information workshops again, be able to get some more counts to see if it's working. Then again, after 6 months, we'll do the same thing. And what these reflectors do is, doesn't create an issue with stormwater or if somebody were to hit it. And it gives more accessibility to emergency management vehicles, because they can just run right over this thing. It's not too cost prohibitive to repair them. We actually have on standby, we actually used to deputy chief, we had a message for first grade to go as well. So whatever actions taken tonight, we're more than happy to go ahead and implement. But again, the way we got here in this, people were not notified, specifically for an operator in the Southeast Water. But what the council is looking at doing is something that is temporary and not permanent. In order for us to do something permanent, we would have to do an ordinance. That's the way it is, the actual details too, of how is that permanent fix going to look like. So, what you have in front of you is just concepts, it's not something that says, tonight, that's what it's going to look like as far as what the permanent solution is going to be. That's basically it. Tony, can answer your questions relative to any discussions just have with the engineers. But again, this would give me the ability to implement one, if not all, of those improvements.
Let's go ahead and back up to public comment. Leslie Deese, if you'd like to approach the podium.
Yes, thank you, Mayor, City Council, and staff. My name is Leslie Deese. My husband and I, Stephen Clark, reside at 729 Main Street. We are located right on the corner of Main and Main. So we are one of the properties that is going to be severely impacted should the City Council close 8th Street. One of the main reasons, we've only been here a couple of years, but one of the main reasons purchased on 8th and lived through the traffic on Main Street is because of the easing ingress and egress. And to close that would certainly impact our lives and potentially even our property value. We could support a diversion plan, which is closing the street is pretty severe. And I know certainly not everyone's impacted by it, but for those of us who are, it's a big deal. So we want to be good neighbors. We understand people on Oakdale. We want to help in that situation, but closing the street will be a major position for us. And that concludes my comments. So I did want to just thank Mr. Smith and the city staff. You know, the 2 years we've been here, they've just been tremendous. And we've had a call for different reasons. They've really, really been helpful. And help from San Diego, and it's not always that way, so I want to commend your city staff. Certainly, as well. Thank you.
Wonderful. Thank you. Councilor Williams, we do have two public comments that need to be read for the record after we have the public that's here to see one of these three meetings, and the second one is. Go through read this after we have the
Good evening. I'd like to repeat my wife's thank you to the council and the staff. We've been here 2 years and had an occasion occasionally we've been had reason to deal with the bigger staff. Professional, helpful, and very impressed with that emergency. Thank you very much. Everybody has helped. I'd just like to reaffirm my wife's comments around the street car. We've all been in 17 Clinton Street. Our house is right
Mark McDonald.
So I live in 708 Bessie, and thank you for the work. The last iteration here was a long ways closing the streets, but my basic problem is we do not have any goals on how many cars we're trying to stop on the units. We have traffic data that show no problem, you know, and we can't tell in the traffic. Generally speaking, all my neighbors are against closing any streets. We understand this is drawn down the road that the residents in South Oakdale are very passionate about the big problem they have and can't measure. We'd like to have goals established on the diversion also, so that when we measure this thing after the diversion is put in place, we can show the results and be able to determine what is successful and what isn't. My concern is that those neighbors will come back and say, well, that's not closing all the 6th Avenue streets, so it's not effective. Because we have a problem we're trying to solve, we don't know how many cars we're trying to stop. So get back to the data. There's another proposal that will come forward here. I'd like the town to implement an overall traffic study for the quadrant. Bring in an engineering firm and establish what reasonable goals are for traffic. Abatement, so that if this topic comes up again, we can explain to the residents that if you don't have this many cars on your street, there's not a problem. In this case, Oakdale did 3 years of measurement, and they were told they were within normal, but they still really are concerned about traffic that appears to be the normal traffic that's been driving down the streets, maybe a little bit more. There may be some cut through, they can't identify what it is. But we're kind of all over the map trying to make a few residents happier. I don't know if we're ever going to be totally happy. But yeah, we just don't have the data to establish the goals or know when we succeed in doing that. Again, my neighborhood is pretty much totally opposed to closing or even one-way districts. The one-way solution that Robert has proposed does allow us to get out to 6th and turn right and left. But I don't know that it's really necessary.
It would, any road closures or reconfigurations would not reduce any traffic, it would just reroute it, and the problem would be shifted from those on Oakdale to other areas like this. That's unfair, it would certainly reduce the traffic on Oakdale, but it would not reduce the overall figures of the cars coming through the southeast quadrant. It would shift the burden to others, and again, I think that's quite unfair and self-serving. Thank you.
those who said, we don't have much basis to go on. We have some property owners interested because they have a lot of cut-through traffic. I would remind you, cut-through traffic occurs 2 hours in the morning, 2 hours in the evening, 5 days a week. It's not a 24/7 problem. Closing roads is a permanent problem, and it creates unintended consequences and more problems than it solves. The idea that I think most everyone can probably get behind is that diverter at 9th and Oakdale, which, I'm not going to get back to Bill Powell, but, okay,
go ahead.
I personally don't believe in seeing the necessity for closing any roads, whether it's on 6th, on Main Street, including 12th, because the function of that diverter, the reason it's in that location is that it's uniquely designed to capture virtually all the traffic that we try to be cutting around the roundabout at Main and 6th. So given its operation for 30 days, all of that traffic is traffic from Chase Road, traffic. It comes in the morning, it comes home in the afternoon. They try to cut around Oakdale, they run into the diverter. It won't take 2 or 3 times, and they'll say, well, that doesn't work anymore. They got to stay on Main Street. It doesn't matter whether it's the morning commute or the afternoon commute, the same thing will happen. No one wants to be diverted up 9th Street and have to make a left-hand turn on Main during a peak hour, you know, with that traffic. It's not going to save them any time at all. I think it does work. My only concern about it is that it's up 24/7. I would very much like to see an analysis in a contractor look at that diverted Alamo screen behind you and determine a way that it can be effectively erected, whether automatically or manually, in the morning from 7 to 9, and taken out at 9. The afternoon from 5 to 7. Even if we had to do it manually with a public works personnel, it's a lot less labor and expense than trying to enforce actions with our police personnel that sit out there every day and try to get tickets. But it will do the job, and I think that if you try to act, it will literally eliminate 90% of the problem. But I caution you, I think road closing is a long way to go. It can only be done by ordinance, not by resolution, temporarily. It has a major impact on the people that live here in Rhode Island, the roads beyond. Thank you.
Hello, my name is Ms. Hicks, and I live at 303 1/2 East 8th Avenue. That's right on the corner of 8th.
Martin Collins. So you'd like this letter written to the town council meeting record. We believe that 9th and Oakdale diversions should stop any traffic cut-through traffic that may occur during rush hours. We would like someone to pick a goal for this project so we can measure when we need it, when we have succeeded. So far, there are no count on how many cars we are trying to stop and what time of day. There should be a traffic engineer involved to deliver a report on the safety impacts for local residents due to street closures. Data needs to be collected on 7th and 8th traffic before implementing any closure tests. We also copies.
Yes.
The second one is from John Covey. I am requesting that this letter be read into the town council meeting record during the debt by council meeting. We are opposed to any and all deviations of
taxpayers' funds and resources on problems that do not exist. If there is a perceived issue, the members of the town council should vote to commission comprehensive traffic study, develop a scope to direct the study, allocate funding through the budget process, then engage an independent third-party contractor. Then they can begin the process of formulating solutions based on the results of the study and involving the residents of the southeast quarter. Should the town council continue to move forward with the current plan of street closures, they would clearly be using their position of influence to placate a small select group of residents' complaints based on emotions, not documented facts. This would be acting against the best interests of the town of Windermere and all of its residents. Thank you, John Hobby, 706 Bessie Street. And the last one is from Randy Haynes. We have read the current plans from the agenda for the Oakdale Street Traffic Calming Program. All discussions so far about placing a diverter has assured us that it will not require any kind of road widening or encroachment to the existing grassy areas of the driveway. However, we are concerned about item number 5 and the recommendations from the engineer, page 33 of the agenda packet. Can you clarify exactly what it means, what the impact would be, and if the town plans to implement it? 5, improve the corner radius for the affected corners to ensure opposing vehicles can safely pass each other and driving is contained within the roadway surface. Instead of making the corner wider, we were hoping there would be some kind of delineators to prevent vehicles from cutting the corner. We are already losing multiple trees in the right of way along East 9th Avenue for the Bessie Stormwater Retention Project. We do not want to lose anything else or have damage to the roots of our trees near the existing road edge along Oakdale or the corner. We have been assured that the town will not excessively burn any one property owner for these trees. Our other concern is that it seems that there is an excessive amount of signs proposed. Part of the benefit was to be less signs than the alternatives. Thank you for agreeing.
Thank you. Council?
Councilmember Williams, there was a question within that that I think Tony's able to respond to. And it relates to the alternate fix, that the concept is in there, that it stays within the confines of the existing right-of-way, and she assured me that her and John had taken a look at it, and it would. So we're not adding any additional improvements to the adjacent property owners or creating any more issues. Okay. Thank you.
Council?
Session?
I do have one question. You know, one of your pictures that shows paved roads, we're not paving roads, though, right?
No, absolutely not.
just let me think here.
Thank you, Mayor Pro Tem. I think this is the 7th meeting that I've sat through regarding this. The first one, there were 48, 47 or 48.
on this to discuss this, but if I recall correctly, this is only the second time we've discussed this.
Okay, this is actually, the diverter was brought up 2017, Robert, when did we?
What came out of this league was, there was no recommendations for any type of adjustments to be made based on the data that they received.
Oakdale at the angle of that meeting, because we pushed for a solution no matter what the data came with, because we knew that there was a problem at the time. I'm kind of in agreement with Councilperson Rose. Is, you know, maybe the diverter, don't block any streets and let's see where it goes. That's me personally. But I think we do need to move forward with something.
I agree with that. I would certainly welcome the diverter. I think, probably it's going to knock out 90% of the problem. My recollection of that data that you were talking about, Robert, is that it's defective from the start, because it's based on GPS or something just wasn't accurate about that data, as I recall.
General area, and then also the turnout. The percentage of what was received as cut-through traffic was, I think, less than 4 or 6%, which doesn't justify any closures. So on one hand, everybody agreed with the overall study as far as the traffic coming from Horizons West, but then didn't agree with the internal cut-through the residential portions. But so utilizing the same exact data as far as the GPS.
All right. Just to clarify, I think I heard it wrong. So, Kimley Associates did study tracks mapping through town to identify a coordinate destination map for all cut-through traffic, all traffic coming through that portion of town. At that point, they didn't recommend any action based on that data.
Correct.
For not only, well, as far as the internal cut-through, because again, they looked at also the internal cut through, they didn't see enough of an issue to create any type of changes. So if you're requesting an engineer, like Mr. Collins stated, I don't know if the engineering group is going to agree with making adjustments because
discussion and not one that is being brought up by staff or
But to be clear, the resident initiative is was the previous plan to block all roads along 6th Avenue or 6th Street and 12th and Main, correct?
Correct. That was what came out of the two public workshops and then long range plan. Six yeah. Oakdale and 12, and then LRP recommended blocking all roadways because of the lack of room for everything that goes to this.
That's true.
All right. Direction. Have a motion.
Yeah, I mean this. The way this is written here is that we're basically giving staff. Move or correction or whatever you call it, and then we'll measure it in 3 months and we'll measure it in 6 months. And I guess the measurement is going to be what they perceive. Like, does everybody feel it's better?
that again, it's as far as setting goals, that would be the only one that would be pretty much.
Yeah. We all need to be a little cautious of because people could divert themselves through other streets and other sections that aren't even on that side. Right. I know when we looked at this way back when, 10 or more years ago, we were concerned that they would feed off to the other side of Main Street. And, one of the ways we worked on that was block off Dirt Green, so that stopped it there, but who knows where else they could try to go.
When was Dirt Green closed off? You're talking about the end of Chase?
Yeah, I think it was like 15 years or more, like maybe 20 years ago.
Yeah, it was before my time.
It's a long time ago.
But again, during this whole process, we'll continue to collect data as far as the amount of trips and the speeds. Again, they're within the 89th percentile, which is not showing or indicating an issue. And then again, what we've done since 2017, when collecting the trips, we haven't seen a significant increase in those trips yet. So again, we'll use those data points and go against after 3 months of this implemented and test the direction once it goes and see if those counts go down at all.
So I would make a motion that we move ahead with the blockade at, I don't know what you call it, blockade, closure of 9th at Oakdale on a temporary basis and give it a few months and see how it works out.
So just putting in the diverter, correct?
Yeah.
No one ways, no closures, just installing the diverters,
yeah.
What we're saying.
I'd like to see what that does first.
The resolution as it's written has the four options. Consent of council, I can hear that. It's looking like the diversion program, start with that first, and then go to maybe another step if it is justified. But this resolution does give me the authorization to take a look at 7th, 8th, and 12th. So
I can definitely see that 12th should be required because they're only going to get as far as 9th if they get thrown back out. The others, I'm guilty of it. Coming down 6th, and sometimes it's backed up, and I'll go through Lake and come out on 7th or 8th.
So I know we're kicking a can down the road for the evaluation criteria, but what is the, at the end of 3 months, what is that evaluation criteria? Is it until the last resident feels it looks okay? Or are we, do we have significant engineering criteria we're trying to meet with this?
We can send out a questionnaire.
Yeah, do a survey. Yeah, we'll
get an opinion on that.
I mean, we can do a survey monkey or we can, you know, again, we're going to be holding those as required in the resolution, hold public input meetings to see if they have seen a relief. And then again, we can continue to do the strips out there to see if those numbers are going down or if people are still within that 85%.
a sweet spot. Those are the only two things. Yeah, I know. But that's the only thing to really quantify is what the people that are out there see every day.
So it gets down to the point of, you know, we meet the criteria now. How are we going to change things and evaluate it in 3 months? A survey is, how do the residents feel about this? And then at what point are we going to say, okay, that's enough residents that feel okay about this? You know, there's no valid criteria we're measuring.
Seem to go very often counter to what's intuitively what the residents feel. So I'm not sure it's worth additional money, but we probably do need a way to quantify that. I just don't know how to go about it. But at this point, at this juncture, I'm not going to discount the residents' demands for doing something.
Residents have made public comment this evening,
right,
that are against this plan.
Well, that's correct. There were several residents that were against no right turns on Ridgewood, my wife being one of them, because she has to go an extra 5 blocks to get home. But, you know, in the end, it's a little inconvenient, but our, you know, we have 20 cars coming through every night instead of 80 to 100. So, if we're increasing safety by leaps and bounds, I say we go for it.
Okay. We do have a motion.
I'll second.
In a second. Vote beginning with Councilperson Martini.
Aye.
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 And it passes 4-1.
Make sure that we take counts prior to and after, so we have variables. Again, we have the numbers going back to 2017, and we do have the 30 days window in order to notify the residents of the traffic that would change. But we'll make sure that this, the counter's out there in the city.
Okay. Yeah, and the school hasn't started back up yet. The 30 days out, but yeah, we'll make that. We've got numbers from earlier this year that's supposed to land, correct?
Yes, we have. From January to February, we have numbers, yes.
Thank you.
The diverter goes in place. Do we have sufficient quantity of replacement?
Yes. That was one of the things we had to do. Yes, 10 or 20 extra.
Yeah. All right, moving on. Item number two, ordinance number 2022-03, permanent right of way. Swap 928 Main Street, an ordinance of the town of Windermere, vacating a 20-foot portion of Dirt Main along the east boundary of 928 Main Street, conveying the fee simple ownership of the vacated portion along the east boundary of 928 Main Street to Molly Rose and Robert L. Fleming, the owners of 928 Main Street, providing finding number 2022-06, amending citizens' boards. An ordinance of the town of Windermere, Florida, amending section 11.04.01 of the division, 11.04.00 of Article 11 of the town's land development code, entitled citizens' boards, to change the minimum and maximum number of members, providing for severability, codification, and effective date.
General question about the next month, Robert. Are we, is this the last of them, or do we still have additional properties
to acquire? We still have additional properties to acquire, but the domino is seen to fall. So there will be some dogging of the roadway. This is all finalized. But I do believe that once we sort of see the benefits of having this. Seniors with their own properties as far as value and developability of that lot, I think they're going to come to us again, you know, from West Heath Avenue property, that initiated another person to come to us and say, let's come and get the swap as well. So as we're getting out, gets out, we're concerned with swaps, we're able to get that, we'll follow.
Okay, thank you.
Just so you guys all understand, some of the main issue is that people were forced to put their septic tanks out on right away. You can't put a road, you can't move dirt main over a septic tank or a drain. I don't know, and I don't think an engineer studied it yet to see if they have acquired that 20 feet and could put their septic into the street if that's far enough. But time will tell.
Yeah, the width of the roadways is between 11 and 14 feet, I think, in that entire area. But I do believe if we maintain that 11 feet, we're not going to have any. So on and so forth. And we have been meeting with people that are interested in swaps to see exactly where it's at. And I do believe in the future, you know, it is part of the multiple model plan, but there is no south connection. So I do believe it's getting more utilized for stormwater retention and vegetation.
Yeah, I think so too, because your main can be in the demo path.
Yeah. Yes, agreed.
Even moved over 20 feet.
General consensus I get from talking with people from the traffic circle south is that they prefer to just leave it rustic, you know, and not super improved like this is going to be here. But, you know, we might need to look at that from a different approach, different angle, on how that, get, that part of the trail gets, I don't know, created or developed.
But we definitely need the stormwater control.
Yeah.
I mean, we're serious.
We need it down here.
And this is, they tell me, the only way they can really do it without infringing on property at all. The town doesn't know.
Yeah, I understand. I know it's a mess now.
Part of the 90% plan is that we're just rezoning leach fields, plot out on those plans. I'm concerned that. Just some of the concerns that Councilman Rose just brought up. You know, if there's leach drain fields out there and we start putting additional vegetation out there, that the serviceability of that.
Well, I don't think there are any going this way.
No, there's no drain fields. That's from North Drive all the way to Park Avenue. But as far as any designs for the southern portion.
It's not everybody. In fact, everybody that I think so far all the swaps don't have their subjects out there, right?
I believe there may be one conflict, but I think it's already further out to where it's not going to have any issues with the road. And any vegetation that we include, we'll make sure it doesn't have any negative impact on that as well.
We just stay on the RSPH and just double check. That's not the case. I assume they can play
it. Yeah, there's nothing from north to Park Avenue.
All right, moving on. Lake Butler Speed Homes by Middlesex Paving. Tanya, would you like to present?
Sure. This is just the speed homes for Lake Butler. Anytime you have to rip out speed homes and come back with new ones, the type that's allowed changes. So this one's just a separate item to approve the speed homes that they've already constructed out there. Yes, sir, this is an accurate fact. We had to work and design with KHA on the fly what was an approved speed hump. We had to take the ones that were there out, and we had to put one back that would be acceptable.
I saw that. I was just wondering if there were additional ones down the rest of
the road. No, we just replaced where they were.
I have a question for my knowledge. Why are they allowed to have speed bumps and we're not allowed to do them anywhere?
I mean, you're talking to roads versus native roads. Yeah.
As far as I know, we weren't allowed to do them down Main or 6th or.
Well, that's because. Yeah. Well, Main and 6th, those
policy amendment adoption. All this is doing is just allowing for a hardship. Once you are vested, reach a certain age, you can tap into the money that you have vested in the town's retirement plan for those identified hardships. So, us as staff can see an issue with this again. We're taking money from what's already vested, what they've already earned. But they still have to meet those thresholds in order for them to pull out money from their retirement system.
And then it requires spousal consent. That's dangerous. And we're taking the chief.
Mike, before I
point out
there. Yeah, I mean, many of these policies sometimes. Since he was already through an FRS plan and wanted to, his contract had money diverted to his personal account, so he had been excluded in the plan itself. And then do that.
But Chief Ogden is on this plan.
Chief Ogden is on the same plan as everybody else, so that's why it's not specifically named. That was an anomaly with Chief McCoy because he wanted the funds through his negotiated contract. And do I have a motion?
Motion to approve.
Second.
Motion to approve by Councilperson Abbott and second Councilperson Rose. Vote begin, Councilperson Martin.
Aye.
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 Passes 5-0. With it being on a Monday as well, I think that helped out with the turnout. Because sometimes if it's on the weekend, then turnout's less because people are traveling. So next year it'll probably be on a Tuesday, so we'll probably see a lot more people coming.
I had COVID, but nobody brought me any pancakes.
Same here.
Ramos.
nothing to report, just waiting for the chief to get better and come back to work. Again, so
well said, we're happy to hear you, though.
So I haven't officially announced my retirement, but from law enforcement, August 7th. But I'll stay on board here and there to get us through accreditation and continue writing grants. I can help Lori out at the front if she needs a day off, fingerprinting. So I won't be gone. And Detective Allen, you know, he retired Sunday was his last day. He's already coming in Thursday to help out. So I knew it wouldn't take long before he would be back. So both of us will still be around for a while.
Okay.
I guess but I'll have my final line all written up soon. That's it. Really busy. We did pour the concrete at the Windermere Recreation Playground this week. Had the managed the fences placed around that playground, getting it ready to be open tomorrow, as you all know. Sidewalk projects have begun along Vernon Avenue. The final repaving project started this week. They're working at night. Travis is coming in to work with them at night. One of the things that I would like to give a shout out is that you may Travis the Public Works Operations. And one of the things that he's doing is he's learning to cover the things that he's given to do, and fix the things that I would do. For example, when we had the engineer come in and take a look at the conversion at Ryan and Oakdale, I had both Brian and Travis in with the engineers. They could ask questions, they could, you know, kind of ask why was he suggesting this or why was he suggesting that. So we're really giving them the opportunity to grow and learn. Not put together, so my team puts those together and then they get them out to the park and get them installed. So they were working on that today. We're going to be installing the swing tomorrow as well. We assisted with relocating the fence out front here, just relocating the sidewalk to give those two old trees straight out in front of me opportunity to come and breathe. So because Condor's here to come out tomorrow to relocate that sidewalk for us, my team will be doing some of the other work that goes with that, putting in some of the things like that. So it's kind of important. We transitioned the landscaping around the Cal Palmer building, moved some of those large potted plants with the assistance of the Garden Club and Councilman Williams. Thank you. We also pressure washed Cal Palmer, made irrigation repairs for the main lines of the Eastern Town Square, picked up the variable lesson. And of course, completed the 90% workshops with residents at the Palmer Trail yesterday. Met with several residents relative to roadway issues from recent heavy rains and storms. We've got several more of those coming up in the next couple of weeks. We moved items to storage for the county administration. We spoke with Park and Parks Recreation that items all up this week. Let's schedule the demolition in the near future. We moved, and then we addressed the fire alarm issues here in Town Hall, made repairs to burns. Park, which is a fourth magnolia. Some of that stuff was moved a little bit from those rainstorms, so we had to get back up there and repair that. But we continued with vegetation. And finally, what I do want to say is they did all of this in and around the fact that we had so many heavy storms. They were practically out on the roads every day, trying to repair those every morning from the storms that we've been having. So I just wanted to give a huge shout out. They never complained. And so I'm so thankful for it. So I'm going to let you all know that you're doing a good job. Thanks.
great to have a priority list like that, especially
if the resident, a resident calls you and wants to find out, you know, where they are, well, the, you know, where their particular issue is. You know, it helped to have that in hand. So,
Tanya, have you guys dropped any improvements as a resident that had an issue about their dock? I think it was on first. Is that better now?
We're still waiting. Their engineer provided us with solutions to a plan that was approved. But we had a meeting scheduled for today at 2 p.m. that had to be canceled due to the fact that the plan wasn't going to be attended in person. And they have not provided us with any indication or solution to what they perceive. So until we receive that information, there's really no reason to. I mean, we've indicated that that's been several times.
I haven't heard any more from them, so I figured you guys would.
Yeah, but there's still communication with them. It's just a matter of them coming up with something to show us what is wrong and how they perceive it to be fixed. So right now, everything is operating as it's permitted.
As it.
Yes, thank you.
I was almost in the middle of that. I'm like, what is an engineer I shouldn't be talking about?
I do have a comment on something that Ms. Moore said. She brought up the Cal Palmer building. To elaborate on that, my father had left and never felt better. Burn club.